Good evening and welcome to the October 24th meeting of the Pembroke Board of Selectmen. We will begin tonight with the Pledge of Allegiance and we will be led by the Girl Scouts. Please rise.
Ready?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Could we also go ahead and give everybody the Girl Scout promise?
On my honor, I will try to serve God and my country, to help people at all times, and to live by the Girl Scout law.
All right.
Well, I want to thank you girls for coming tonight. That was wonderful. You did such a good job.
Well, the girls just wanted to say thank you for allowing us to use the town green. It is to celebrate Juliet Gordon Lowe's birthday, which happens to be on Halloween. It was her favorite holiday, and she established the Girl Scouts in 1912. And so this is our day to celebrate her. So we'll be having a little picnic. And we'll be having a little fun for the girls. They'll learn to strike some matches. They'll learn to make some campfires. And basically just be with each other and be Girl Scouts. So thank you very much.
Very good.
Well, thank you for coming in. Right. Again, you girls did a great job. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, ladies.
All right.
Thank you for coming in.
Bye, honey.
Thank you very much.
Okay, I'll just handle this. Come on, take your paper.
Please note that this meeting is being made available to the public through a live video and audio broadcast on Comcast Government Access Channel 15 and is being recorded for broadcast at future dates. Comments made in open session will be recorded. On tonight's agenda, we have Jacqueline Dial, and she's coming before us this evening to talk to us about a change in location of her Class 2 license. Yes, please. Thank
you. I'm here to change the address of Class 2 license to 290 Center Street. We lived in Pembroke for 40 years, sold our house, moved to Quincy, but our business is primarily South Shore, and we wanted to keep, because most of us, what we do is we are auto remarketers. Go to auctions, get the cars repaired, and sell them to other dealers. They're transported. We do not have anything out there, you know, cars. We do not sell to people, just to other dealers.
Okay.
I don't know what else to say.
We also have a letter from the Zoning Board of Appeals, which is a letter of approval. So does the board have any questions?
I just have one question. How many cars do you have that much?
It depends. In a month, it could be 20.
Wow, 30. That's a lot.
It all depends. It's very cyclic. It's a different business, you know. But it's, we have nothing to do with the public. Sorry guys, we want to kind of a good price, we can't help it, so, anyway.
Well, you've had a license approved by this board previously for the same business, so we're well aware of what you do.
Mm-hmm.
And so are there any other questions from the board?
This is in the Real Estate Rocks building?
Yes.
Do I hear a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we approve the Class 2 auto dealer's license for Jacqueline Dial of Dial Works to be used at 290 Center Street. Retail sales of automobiles, provided there is no outside display, storage, or sales.
I have a motion. Is there a second? Second by Bill. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you very much.
And it's my birthday today, so.
Wow.
Oh, happy birthday.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming in.
Thank you.
Just like to mention for the record, Selectman Trabuco is not here tonight. He is out of town. The second item on the agenda is Sun Edison issue. It's a legal document that is still being discussed by the attorneys, and it concerns our solar farm, and we're going to put that agreement and decision by this board off for 1 week.
Mr. Chairman, it's pretty much done. There was some fine-tuning that was agreed upon by Nick Sicchello and town council and myself. If we were hard-pressed to have you folks vote for it tonight, we would have, but we want the representatives of Onyx to be present when the amendment's adopted by the board. So it'll be on next Monday's agenda.
So timing is no issue for the town. We're not going to be penalized at all. And as Ed said, we'll have people here to explain it and be able to answer questions if we had any. So that will be added on to our next meeting. Down to board action items. This is a review of minutes and agendas that are posted on the town's website as our bylaw says must be done. I took it on myself to take a look at the website, and only going by what is posted, I have discovered that since I did the first survey in July, the second one was done the first week in October. And the difference is an increase in about 10%, which is an improvement. However, when you look at the agendas that are posted and the minutes that are posted, it's only 51% compliance. Now, in addition to having a bylaw that requires the posting of agendas and minutes, we also passed that bylaw that I have referenced. So I see it that it's up to this board to enforce that for several reasons. So I think everyone has had a chance to take a look at it. I don't want to go through and identify any particular board, department. I don't think that's necessary. What I'm looking for from the board is some ideas on how we can improve the 51% compliance to a much higher number. So
I have one comment to make on
yes,
that.
Yes, Matthew.
I was hoping we could do a survey of not only the 50% that aren't completing the requirement, but the 50% who are. And ask them what's standing in the way of them completing it. And for the ones who are completing it, we could ask them, how are they able to do so?
That's a good idea. Mr. Thorne has sent out a letter after the first survey was done. We have a copy of that in this information.
Can I just add something to that?
Yes, Bill, sorry, go ahead.
I think also maybe if we're sending something back out to these people that that are not complying, that maybe we could say that they could put it in as a draft, because there's a lot of them that that may be only meeting so many times a year and not on a regular basis, so they won't be posted in minutes until after they're approved. But I think we talked about this one time before about they could post them as a draft, not as minutes.
That's correct.
And at least if it was a draft of what took place that night, then there may be some concern of a citizen that says, oh, I didn't realize that was coming up, or there was something going on there, so they could address it when the minutes do come out. I think it's kind of important to have these minutes out, because if there's something that it takes place in one of the board's action items, and there's a appeal process in there somewhere, and nobody appeals it within the right amount of time, and then the minutes come out, it's already beyond the time that they can appeal it. So some of them may be critical that that's done, you know, right away. So at least if there was a draft done, then somebody could recognize that there was something being discussed about something they were interested in, and they could find out more about it, and then possibly, you know, those particular minutes or something could be done, or the person could find out if there was something that they didn't particularly care about, and then it would be in a draft form, and then the real minutes could be approved at some time. But that is may come under several of the boards in the town that it might be critical if somebody was talking about something and made a vote about some particular thing. The people would only have a certain amount of days to appeal that. So if those minutes aren't done within those certain amount of days, then they wouldn't be able to look at that. Do you know what I'm saying?
That's correct, yeah. Yeah.
So it is kind of critical. So if we allow drafts to be put in there, at least the draft should be done right away. So we could probably put a time limit on the drafts and say that either the minutes or a draft have to be done within 1 week.
Well, I believe in the open meeting law there is a provision that you can submit a draft, and then if corrections are made, then you submit those corrections as a final
list
of minutes. Now, this board came up with the new bylaw that we had passed because we all seem to meet on the same night, and the selectmen would like to know, and I think it's part of our job to know, what other people are considering, what they're ruling on, what their issues are, what their problems are, and so I just think it's up to us who thought that this was the right thing to do to try to get it done. Now, in the past, I've had to, I was responsible for posting minutes of board meetings. And in the business world, I had that job a few times as well, when there were many more people that you had to write down what was said and what was voted on. It is not an easy job. It takes discipline, and you have to do it quickly, and there isn't any reason to put off writing the minutes. So it is a very important position that has to be filled by a person who is willing to do that. So we've had a good suggestion from Bill. Ed, you sent out a letter before. Do you have any comment that you'd like to make?
No, and I think Matthew's point is well taken. I think, you know, is there a problem? Why haven't you, your board, your committee, not being able to not comply with the town's bylaw? You know, what's the reasoning behind it? So I think that's great that we would send out a reminder to that and go from there. And on while we're on that subject of the open meeting law, just a reminder to the board and to everybody concerned that Brian Riley from Copeland and Page will be having a open meeting law seminar tomorrow afternoon at 3 for departments, and at 6 o'clock for boards and commissions. So, you know, folks are invited to attend. It'll be televised. So I saw the email that Sabrina sent to you, Matthew. So we'll we'll have a special CD for you, so you can take it home and watch the presentation by Mr. Riley.
Now, the 3 o'clock one is again for who?
Well, it could be for anybody that wants to get there, but okay. It's specifically for staff.
Okay, fine. Because I'll be attending that one at 3 o'clock. So, again, I don't want to beat this to death, but speaking of the open meeting law, that's another reason why we have to have these posted. That people that want to access minutes to meetings, whether they're selectmen or a private citizen of the town, they should be able to do it. And we're charged with making that happen. So I think we can try those suggestions and let's see where we go from there. Okay. Next item on our agenda is a discussion on opening the recycling center on Sundays, and it's been done in the past for leaf disposal.
Yeah, I was chatting with Mike Valenti, the landfill manager, and I think what's happened is that he has opened the second portion of the facility to allow people to come in with their leaves. It's more accessible and user-friendly than it's been in the past. So I think by next Monday, I'll, after talking with Mike on Saturday, and that's a reminder of Hazardous Material Day, we'll be at the Recycling Center this Saturday from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. And it's on the website, and we have information in the office about what is acceptable by Clean Harbors, which will be doing the work for us. So that's this Saturday at the Recycling Center from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. That's our semi-annual event that we have. I'll be talking to Mike on Saturday, and we'll come up with a definitive target for November for if he thinks we should open up the recycling center on Sundays for the month of November.
Okay. So we'll add that item, Sabrina, to next week's agenda. Thank you,
Ed. Mr. Chairman, I think opening the recycling center as early as November 6th, which is the first Sunday in November, is a good practice. I mean, it's been very successful the last few years. It gives people an opportunity that, you know, work Saturday or do their yard work on Saturday to have a place to take it so that it doesn't blow all over the place and be counterproductive. People have asked me, you know, a couple of times at town meeting and around town about how we're going to do it again this year. So there are very few programs, I think, that we offer that kind of interest people and excite people a little bit about, you know, being able to do something that doesn't cost them money. And I think this is a good way to do it. I think the cost to us is about $400 per Sunday to be open. And I think it's money well spent.
Thank you, Arthur. I agree with you completely. When we first started this several years ago, people called and said exactly what you said and asked us if it could be done, and we did it. And it's very well attended, and it's a good public service.
Yeah, I mean, the Hazmat Day has been, you know, something that's blossomed over time as well. And we've got a lot of you know, pesticides and gasolines and oils and paints and, you know, oil-based material that we've got out of the waste stream, and that's been a good thing as well. So I think those are two things that we can do and have done successfully in the past, and I think we should continue it. So if Mr. Valenti says that November 6th is a good day that works for him, okay. I'd like to see us go.
Good. Thank you. Thank you, Arthur.
Thanks.
We will address the minutes of the Selectmen's meeting of October 17th. Do I have a motion on those minutes?
Move to accept the minutes of October 17th, 2016.
Second. Motion by Arthur, second by Bill. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none. That's unanimous. Thank you. Old business. I'm going to ask Bill if he'd like to talk to us about all the work that's being done on the fish.
Actually, some really good news for the residents of Pembroke and also for the juvenile heron fish that are leaving Oldham Pond. Because of the drought, we had no water to get to the diversion pipe that Brockton supplies that goes to Silver Lake, and there's a cutoff in there that actually goes out to a different section of a stream that is in backside of the dam, but there wasn't enough water even to get to the diversion pipe. So we actually we dug out an area by the dam and put sandbags all around the front of the gate that was there to save as much water as we could. So there's only a small stream in the middle. We were able to get thousands of fish out over the weekend and downstream. So we've blocked up the other dam that's down off of Fabermark Street, and we put a few boards in here and there to raise the water level in different areas and save as much water as we possibly can. We actually made some of the boards with holes in the middle so that we could save as a lot of water, and only a certain amount would come out through the boards, which was a pretty good idea. And then we found a large blockage between Oldham Pond and Furnace Pond because of the water being so low, and we actually went under the road and cleaned all of that out and got that out so that we have probably the most fish that I've seen come out of Oldham Pond in a Furnace Pond the other day. As soon as we unblocked that and we got the water running out there, even the neighbors came out that live on in the area down there to help us with the juvenile fish, because there were so many that came through that they were actually washing up on the sand and on Furnace Pond in the dry areas there. So we were running around picking them up off of the sand and putting them back in the little stream that we had to get them into the pond. But there were definitely was thousands and thousands of fish that we got out of Oldham Pond. And the way that it's working now is it's working really well. We're saving water, doing what we're doing, and we're also getting the fish out. So worked out really well over the weekend. So it's a good thing. And it's, hopefully those fish will be back 3 years from now. So it's still a lot of work to do. And like I always say, if there's anybody that's interested that wants to help out or do some stuff to help the fish, then you can always contact me or the Selectman's office, and we'll get a hold of you. And there's always a bunch of work to do, so you can always use the help.
Thank you, Bill. I know the people on your committee have really spent a lot of time on this project, and it's over and above what we ask you to do, so thank you for doing that. I did have one question. We've had several inches of rain lately, thankfully. Has that made any appreciable difference?
It has helped so that we've got a little bit of a flow that goes down to the dam. And like I said, if we opened the gate at the dam, it would probably drain Furnace Pond. So that's why we put all of the sandbags all around the gate, so that we only allow a little bit of water at a time to go in there. But it was quite a good scene to see. As we were putting the sandbags in place to do this, the fish were jumping on top of the sandbags. because they wanted to get out. So it was pretty good. Amazing. So I do have some videos, and I'll probably send them along to Pembroke News so that they can post it, and we'll post some of them on the website. But it's good that we're getting them on the move, especially before the winter. They're usually going in September. Here it is almost November, and really just starting to move now. So, but there was quite a few, probably the most that I've seen in a long time that is coming out of Oldham Pond. So it's a good thing.
Very good. Ed, the town administrator's report, please. A
couple of things, Mr. Chairman. I've already talked about Hazmat Day in the open meeting or seminar. October 7th, I attended the MMA's legislative breakfast over in Bridgewater, and it wasn't a full breakfast bill, so you didn't miss a whole lot as far as muffins and fruit were concerned. So, but they talked, you know, about several topics, but the two most important were the public records law that was adopted by the legislature and the changes that were made to that law. And then, of course, the municipal modernization bill, which is the 125-page document that even the summary is 17 pages long. So, but and there are things that we're taking advantage of as part of that. So that was, you know, informative. One of the things I wanted to share with you is I had Sabrina give you a spreadsheet regarding the solid waste numbers from basically from the reports that I get from Easy Disposal and from Waste Management, where we take our recyclables. And it's an interesting quarter of a year report in that it appears that the automated system in Pembroke is working to the tune of saving us tonnage in what goes on the curb. Just trash itself is down about 140 tons. And if you just divide that by three, you can do the math, and you see that we're saving, you know, probably around 40 tons of trash. And multiplying that by $55 a ton, you're talking about considerable savings in the first quarter of this fiscal year. Our recycling tonnage is also down just a tad, but not as much as the trash tonnage. And so that means our recycling percentage, recycling tonnage divided into the total tonnage, is up by a whole percent. Another interesting aspect of the new program is that it appears that the volume of vehicular traffic at the recycling center on Saturdays is double what it was a year ago. Mr. Valenti says that in a normal Saturday, it would have been between 100 and 125 cars on a Saturday, and now they're getting between 200 and 225 to 250 cars on a Saturday. So it appears that people are using the recycling center more. I mean, almost a dozen times a week, it appears, that people come in and get a new recycling sticker. We had a couple people today, I think, come in. Mm-hmm. So, you know, people are, the program, the automated program is working. It's reducing the tonnage that we're paying for. And a lot of the recyclables that sometimes would have been put into the trash are now being taken to the recycling center. So it in the first quarter of the year, it's great news that this program is taken off, and we appreciate the cooperation of the residents to make the program work like it is.
As you said, can I have something to add to that?
Oh, certainly, Bill.
Mr. Chairman, I actually also talked to the DPW director and the lieutenant at the police department about people dumping trash around town. And it seems like that kind of has increased in a bunch of different areas that that probably haven't been dumped before, but there's some that are probably kind of unique that they drive by and throw the stuff out of their vehicle or whatever onto the side of the road or pull in quickly and dump it out of their trunk or the back of their truck. We've cleaned up a bunch of areas around town, and it's more trash has ended up in those particular areas. So we're looking into possibly a camera system that we can put into these areas to either video or take pictures of anybody that would come into that area. One of them would be the streams that they were dumping trash in off of Center Street, which is not a good thing. So we can't block everything off and block all the, some of the roads are very public, and there's some that travel quite frequently where they're dumping this stuff. And I think they actually dumped a gasoline tank at Monroe Street where the walking trails are and stuff. They just dumped it in the parking lot there and took off the other day. So any place that we find that is consistently that they're dropping trash off, I think we're going to try to put some type of a camera system in there that can take pictures of people and prosecute them to the full extent of the law, that you know, they should be using the recycling center or their regular trash that's in there. So just wanted to bring that up for the public. So yeah.
Well, regular littering of paper cups and things like that from the fast food stores is bad enough, but when they're dumping oil tanks off and other things, not good.
Well, there was one other thing that one of the people brought up to me was that there's a couple of stores around that, from what I understand, were asked to put rubbish containers outside of their stores that sell candy, ice cream, lottery tickets, all that kind of stuff, to go products, and it ends up on the streets. So I know that there's been a few stores that have been asked to put rubbish containers outside of their building because the kids come and take the stuff, and then as they're leaving, they throw it, and it's just trash that gets on the ground that shouldn't be there. So I think that should be addressed sometime in the future here. I don't know who we should really address that with, but in order for them to get their permits, maybe that would be something on the permits that they should have trash receptacles outside while they're open. Not necessarily while they're closed, because everybody be dumping trash in there when they're closed, but you know, at least on their open hours, they should put some type of a container outside so that people put either recyclables or trash in those containers, so they don't end up on the streets and they don't end up in the ponds.
Hmm. Good. Ed, did you have anything else?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Anyone have an ask the selectmen issue? I had one that I'd like to mention. The selectman's office did get a call from a resident who was questioning the sign on the new restaurant that's going in where Oliveira's restaurant was. And there was a question about the type of sign and the district that restaurant is in. And we referred to the zoning enforcement officer for him to review that sign, and we'll be following up on that with the resident. Under new business, does anyone have any new business? I'd just like to briefly review this letter that we received from the Department of Energy Resources. And it's in reference to the town of Pembroke's municipal load aggregation plan. And I'll just read a little paragraph here. I am writing to inform you that the town of Pembroke has completed its consultation with the Department of Energy Resources pursuant to General Law Chapter 164 in the development of its municipal load aggregation plan, detailing the process and the consequences of aggregation. And the last paragraph in the letter to the town of Pembroke, the DOR is satisfied that the town of Pembroke and Colonial, which is the company that we are working with to provide electrical service at a reduced cost, are undertaking this effort with realistic expectations of the municipal benefits that may accrue to future aggregation plan subscribers. Similarly, we recognize the commitment of Pembroke as it seeks to bring value to the community through this public aggregation. So that's just an update on our plan that we've been working on and will continue to work on for a discounted cost of electricity for anyone who would like to sign up. We're not ready to give you any further details tonight, only to say that we are moving forward. So, do we have need for our executive session, Mr. Thorne?
Yes, sir. Very quick one.
Can I have a motion on an executive session?
Sure, Mr. Chairman. I would move that the Board of Selectmen enter executive session to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining or litigation. If an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the bargaining or litigating position of the public body, and the chair so declares, and that's involving DPW and fire.
We have a motion for Arthur. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Bill. All those in favor, it'll be a voice vote. Matthew?
Yes.
Bill?
Yes.
Arthur?
Yes.
And I vote yes. The next regularly scheduled meeting of the Board of Selectmen will be Monday, October 31st, 2016. Costumes will be at your approval.
That sounds good.
Yeah.
So we're going to come in costume?
It is Halloween evening, isn't it? We have no plans to re-enter into public session after executive session, and we'll take no public votes. So that's it for our meeting for this evening. Thank you very much for tuning in, and we'll look for you on Halloween evening.